invite the servant of God, our bishop and our father in this house, to come and share the word of God with us this morning in the name of Jesus. If you can put your hands together, please, let's celebrate the man of God as he comes to the pulpit in the name of Jesus. Amen, 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 amen. Glory to Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. Karibu sana, askofu.
Hallelujah. The day that the Lord has made, and we are going to rejoice and be glad in it. We thank God for giving us strength of our body, strength of our mind, and helping us to be in His presence this morning, so that we may worship, we may pray, we may make our request known to Him. We thank God for that very beautiful time we had of prayer and worshiping the Lord and even intercession. And now we come to another moment where we want to share the word of God together. And I thank God we have continued to come to you live from the Full Gospel Churches of Kenya, Kiambu, and I want to bring the word of God to us. And today the Lord gave me a word from the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We are going to read from verse number 3 to 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, from verse number 3 to 5. This is Paul writing, and when Paul was writing these words in 2 Corinthians, in a way, he was defending his ministry. He was defending his ministry because there were some people who felt like Paul was not an appointed apostle, just like the others who were with Jesus. And therefore, Paul was, in a way, defending his ministry. I want us also to, let's just read from verse number 1 so that we may see the context of his argument. From 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 1, by the humility and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. I, Paul, whom am timid when face to face with you, but bold towards you, when away. I beg you that when I come, I may not have to be as good as I expect to be toward some people who think that we live by the standards of this world. I want us to pay attention to verses number 3 to 5, where Paul says, For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient, to make it obedient to Christ. And we will be led to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this day that you have made. And you have allowed us even to sit, to listen to your word this morning. This morning as I share your word, I pray that you may give me utterance. And you may help me to communicate the word as you have dropped it in my heart. I pray that this morning there are people that are feeling weak. There are people that are feeling victimized by the situation and they feel low. There are others that feel depressed and they feel like they do not have, they don't know what to do with their lives and the circumstances that surround them. But I thank you today because you have come to tell us that we are not victims and we are living above the challenges of life. Thank you, Lord, because you are going to deliver us from the idea of feeling victims, oppressed, mistreated. But you are going to help us to live above board as overcomers. For the Bible says we are more than conquerors, and nothing can separate us from your love. And therefore, I pray for ourselves, even as we listen to these words, that this word be encouraged and uplift us. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Amen. Today I want to talk about how we can overcome victim mentality. Victim mentality. How we can overcome victim mentality. When I talk about overcoming victim mentality, this is something very psychological, because when one has the victim mentality or is a victim in his mental faculties, you feel powerless and unable to solve problems or cope with the situation effectively. And what we are going through in our country and in the world today, it is very easy for people to become victims of circumstances. So a person suffering with victim mentality feels and unable to solve problems of life. You also tend to see yourself or your problems as a catastrophe in your life, something that you have no control. When you are suffering from victim mentality, you also tend to think others are purposefully trying to hurt you. When you feel a victim, you also see others as enemies and people who are trying to hurt you. When you are also suffering from this mentality, you believe you alone are targeted for mistreatment. At this one, we can find it in the Bible when Elijah killed the prophet of Baal and he was threatened by Jezebel. He led away, and where he went and laid down under the broom tree, he asked God to kill him because he felt a victim and he felt like everyone want to kill me. They want to kill me. I alone am the one who is targeted. I'm the only one who is left. And therefore, he wanted to die. He felt mistreated. He had given up. When you are suffering from this victim mentality, you hold tightly to thoughts of feeling that you are afflicting, you become afflicting, you have no control. And this we can see very well when we look at the children of Israel when they were living in Egypt. They were under slavery, they were actually slaves and under a slave master. And of course we know they were treated. Therefore, they were victims. And as a victim, it is very easy when you feel that you are a victim, you resign to fate. Because victims and what you will do, you will always complain. And you believe that you have no control of the situation that you are in. And therefore you are ready to die. And you can easily become irresponsible and careless in life because you are a victim. Furthermore, victims have no light. You feel you have no light. You feel that you need not even to enjoy life. So when you suffer from this mentality, you resign to fit, and you can easily become irresponsible. And when you are a victim, even as a Christian, and this is very serious, and it is something that we need also to take care of. When, as a Christian, if you are suffering from victim mentality, even if you know God, and you know that God is able, what you do when you go to prayers, you actually do not pray. What you do, you lament. And you mourn. So your prayers are always mourning, and lamenting, and complaining. As a Christian, and that's why this morning, as I speak, I pray that God will deliver us from this mentality. Praise the Lord. Can you say amen wherever you are? You say, may God deliver me from this mentality so that my prayers will not be mourning. And it is easy for a man or a woman of God who feels that he or she is a victim. When he goes to God, he does not pray, but he moans, he cries, he lives with pain because he's a victim. And sometimes he feels that everyone is against me, even God is against me. And therefore, you never see anything positive. A victim, a person suffering from victim mentality, never see anything as positive. And these people, we call them pessimists. Whatever they see it as a failure. And each psychologist will say, when they look at the grass, that the water is in the middle, how they look at that grass, they see that if you tell them to define or to say what they are seeing, what they see a grass that is half empty. That person, we call them a pessimist, who sees a grass half empty. But a person who looks at life positively, even when the grass is halfway, they see a grass that is half full. That means that person has hope. But a pessimist doesn't have hope. He decides to fit. And therefore he can live anyhow. Furthermore, I am a victim. Even sometimes they don't care about their life. And this one we can experience, we can see this when we look at people in the street, how people behave in the street. You can look at some of those people who drink. They live careless life. They can sleep anywhere. They don't care. Even they have no value of life. They don't care how people look at them. So even they don't care about their reputation. Because they have resigned, they have said, furthermore, people know that I am a drunkard. And drunkards behave like that. And they can say whatever they want because they believe they are going to be excused, because drunkards, that is how they believe. They behave. So they resign. And they live their life in the most basic way. Theirs is only to satisfy the very most basic need in their life. Somebody who talks about the hierarchy of needs, a person who's called Maslow, and he talks about the basics of life, the needs of life. He talks about the needs of life, and he talks about the five basics of life, and he talks about those needs that are physiological needs, that are the lowest: food. And when one is suffering from this victim mentality, all that he needs is to eat. Even where that person sleeps, he doesn't worry, he doesn't care. And this is what we find even with some of our disadvantaged people who live in the street. They don't care. They don't care about their security. They live in streets. They sleep in streets. They eat in the garbage. Even they don't care about their health. So they decide to fit. They say, I am a victim. Furthermore, even if I die, I'm worth nothing. And may God deliver us from this victim mentality. And it is easy for a Christian to resign, even especially even the way we are today, the things that we are having. Sometimes we become victims because of some of the things that we suffer. You can easily become a victim because of what you are going through. Bad experience. I know even today as I speak, probably someone is listening to me. Probably you have been divorced. You are separated from your husband, or you are separated from your wife. And therefore there is trauma in your life. Probably you have lost your job. We have seen people who lose their job. When they lose their job, they become depressed and they resign. And that trauma can make you a victim. Probably you lost your job. Probably you lost even your business. You invested so much, and all of a sudden, this coronavirus struck, and the business is no longer doing well. And therefore, you are not even making ends meet. And therefore, you feel like you are a victim. And you can easily resign because you feel even the world is treating me unfairly. The government is treating me unfairly. It is easy, even like now, even to fall victim, and we start complaining. And we don't see anything positive that is happening. Even when the government is trying to manage the situation as it is today. But my message today, may God help us to overcome this mentality. And Paul was talking about this war and this victim mentality is a kind of war in our mind. It is a state of mind that brings war in our mind, and he talks about that, for we live in the world, but we do not wage war as world does. And therefore, as men and women of God, as people who trust God and who believe in God and who believe in the power of God, our war against the situations and the things that we face in life should be different. Should be different because we wage war not as the world does. And the Bible continues to say in verse number 4 that the weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. We should not look at things the way the world looks at things. Because our happiness and our joy does not only come from what we have and what we get, but we are a different people. And therefore, the Bible says, continues to say, the weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that is set itself against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. There are those ideas, the ideologies that comes to our mind. Our thinking pattern, our negative thinking pattern, we come against them in the name of Jesus. And we pull down, we call them strongholds. Those negative thoughts, we call them strongholds. We become a forward thinkers. And that is what we need to demolish. We bring down the stronghold. And as I speak right now, I pray, may God help us to defeat those negative thoughts, negative ideas, that we do not feel like we have resigned. You can remember when Lazarus died and Jesus delayed. Mary and mother, they had sent some people to tell Jesus that Lazarus is dead. But when he appeared, Mary and mother could not see Jesus raising Lazarus. But they continued to cry and say, if you are here, our brother would not have died. So to them, there was no hope, because when you become a victim, you become hopeless. Even when Jesus asked, where is he? They told him, he has been dead for the last 4 days. He is even stinking. So you need not to bother going there. So when you become a victim, you resign. And you do not see any hope. And I would want us, may God help us to change. Even if our business has gone low, the Lord is able to resurrect them in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Even if the churches have been closed, the Lord will restore our members and we shall have our normal services again in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Even if you have lost your job, you are not done, you are not finished. You will be reinstated or get another job, even a better one. Hallelujah. You are not done. So do not suffer. The Lord is still in control. He is still on the throne. He is able to do that no man can do. Praise the Lord. And therefore we need to overcome the fitting mentality and believe that the Lord is able. And it is very important for us to overcome this. When you are a victim and you are suffering from victim mentality, it can also be a personal attitude of worry. We need to overcome worry. And worry can be a stronghold. Probably there are people who are so much worried. We need to overcome worry. Because worry can be a stronghold. Because we can be, there is a reason for us to be worried now. Because our children are not going to school. We are not doing our job as normal as we used to do. And therefore, worry can become, you can become a victim of worry. But may God help us and redeem us from this worry. And when we become worried, we start seeking the approval of other people. And this can be even a stronghold. Anything that you can, you make, that you become a victim and you feel that you cannot do anything. So you become, it is like you have been put into prison. And if you are not careful, you can even hate people, you can isolate yourself, you can become so insecure. And as I said, you are not able to move forward. And therefore, it is very important for us to take every thought captive. And when Paul was saying that we take every thought captive, in this first number, we demolish, on the contrary, verse number 5, we demolish argument and every pretension that is set itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to God. This word captive, to the captive, it means to control. It means you need those negative thoughts come to you. The Greek meaning of this word captive is to take control. There are things that we need to take control of. It also means to conquer. There are thoughts that we need to conquer. We need to conquer those negative thoughts. It also means to bring to submission that you are not controlled by negative thoughts, but you have taken them captive, and now they have submitted to you. It means to bring under control those evil thoughts, those negative thoughts. You bring them under control. And may God help us that we can control our thoughts. We can conquer the negative thoughts of being a captive. We can bring to submission the negative thoughts. As I was thinking about this message, the Lord led me to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, which I want us to look at briefly. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And here it is Paul who is giving a testimony of a certain people who are called Macedonia. And he's saying, and now brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given to Macedonian churches. And he says, in the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy, their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability entirely on their own. I want you to look at the definition of these people in verse number 2. What Paul is giving a testimony. And in fact, Paul is happy because of these Macedonian churches. Because he's saying, the way you look at these people, the way you see these people, they are a severe tribe. They are people at a tribe. But you can see, Paul, in a very graphic way, he tried to join two words. He is trying to compare, to contrast the two things here. He is trying to compare trials with joy. Then he will there, after the next phrase, he talks of extreme poverty. Then he brings rich generosity. And this is ironical in a way. It is a paradox. It is not something that you can explain. Because when you are tried, you cannot have joy. But the opposite is true with these people of Macedonia. When they were tried, their trials bring overflowing joy. That means even if they were tried, they did not allow the hurts that were coming from outside to affect their souls and their hearts. They remained joyful. Praise the Lord. You can be joyful. You can rejoice in the midst of trial because you are not afflicted. Hallelujah. Can you tell somebody you can rejoice even if you are tried? Just look at somebody. You can rejoice. Paul and Silas. You remember Paul and Silas? They were in prison. They were tried. They were persecuted. They were captives. They were victims there. But they did not allow jail to victimize them. Instead, the Bible says, they rejoiced and they praised the Lord until they were delivered. And I want to tell us one way to be delivered from this victim mentality is to rejoice in the Lord. And no wonder Paul says in Philippians chapter 4, verse number 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. And I say again, rejoice. Do not allow what you are going through to oppress you, to rob your joy. Because joy is the fruit of the Holy Spirit, and it is given by God. And if you know God, you can bear fruit. And the fruit of joy is born when we are at a trial. And that is the season to bear the fruit of joy, when you are under oppression. Hallelujah. Can you say, I'm going to bear this fruit, the fruit of joy, because this is the season. Praise the name of the Lord. So you can have joy. So they rejoiced, Paul and Silas. They rejoiced, Macedonians were tried, but they were overflowing with joy. They did not allow the oppression, the trials to victimize them. Then the second thing that we can see, their extreme poverty. When one is extremely poor, I don't know the kind of poverty that they were going through, but it looks like they were poor, and they looked poor. The Bible says it welled up. Another version of the Bible says it welled up. Yes, this version of the Bible says it welled up. Ni kama kisima kilichipuka in rich generosity. Do poor people give? Poor people don't give. Poor people are not generous because they look forward to be given. Furthermore, they have nothing to give. But this Macedonian, although they were poor, Bible says that this poverty, that it welled up to rich generosity. That they did. And if you continue, you'll see, verse number 4, the Bible says, they ardently pleaded with the leaders of the church for the privilege of sharing in the service of the Lord's people. And they give and they exceeded the expectation of the leader. And they give themselves first of all to the Lord. And then they give by the will of God, and then they give themselves, even they give themselves to the ministry. What am I want to bring here? Is that when you think you are a victim, you are not even creating. Because these people, they were poor as they were sick. And it is very important for you to know that people can make you victim and say, may God help us. When people tell you you are victim, refuse it. So you say, maybe we sit up to buy. Because people can tell you you are poor. If somebody tell you you are poor, tell them I'm rich. Praise the Lord. I remember when I went abroad and I went to Europe, the tendency of people when they go to a foreign country, especially to those countries, the countries in Europe and America, most of the time people go and beg. And I was determined as I left the country, and I told myself, when I go to this land, I will preach the gospel, but I will not borrow, and I will not act poor. And I remember in the many churches that I went, I told them, in our country, Kenya, now we are blessed. We are ready to send missionaries. And what you can do, you can come and partner with us, and we reach out to the unreached people groups. And I could tell them, we in Kiambu, we have already sent a missionary, and we have been supporting a missionary for the last 17, 16 years. Even we have built a school, we have supported. And then I told myself, I'm not going to seek sympathy, because people may make you poor. When people tell you you are poor, don't believe that you are poor. Say, I am able. Because the poverty, the worst poverty, victim, the victim mentality makes you a captive, and you will always want to seek pity. You want to be pitied by people. You want people to sympathize with you. And it so happens, you cannot even be creative. And that is why I always say, the worst poverty is the poverty of the mind. Can you say the worst poverty is the poverty of the mind? It is not lack of money. It is not lack of clothing. It is not lack. The worst poverty is the poverty of the mind. Because poverty of the mind kills creativity and seeks sympathy. You can write that in capital letter. Poverty of the mind kills creativity and seeks sympathy. When you are poor, you are no longer creative, and you will always seek sympathy. I can bring a very sad example of a certain missionary son who went to visit. His father was once a missionary in a certain area. I'm not going to mention. And when this son of that missionary came many years after, he found an old man. And this man was very old. But when that old missionary was there, he helped this old man to build a house. And he built a small, a good house, and then built a katank for that old man. And then after many years, the son of this missionary was coming back. And this young missionary, or the son of the old missionary, went to see what the father had done. When the old man saw this son of this old missionary, he told him, "It is good that you have come, because you can see this house your father built for me. Even the tank has started leaking now, and it is good because now you are here to repair it." For more than 40 years, huyu mtu alijengewa tank na kanyumba, and he has never improved, and he's been waiting for this white man to come back and repair the tank. Poverty of the mind. And I said, the poverty of the mind kills creativity. You do not progress. When you are a victim, you do not go forward. In fact, what happens is that even you lose what you have. And may God redeem us today in the name of Jesus, that we shall overcome this poverty of the mind, and we move forward, because we can say forward ever and backward never. Praise the Lord. The children of Israel, when they were delivered, and when they were in the wilderness, and they faced some problems in the wilderness, they started remembering Egypt, and they started saying, there were graves in, there were cemeteries in Egypt, there were pumpkins and watermelon, and therefore they wanted to go back to eat pumpkins and watermelon. But may God deliver us in the name of Jesus. We shall not go back to Egypt to eat watermelon and pumpkins. We are going to that promised land that is growing with the honey and the milk. Praise the Lord. That is our praise. And we shall press forward. And that is why Paul said, "I am pressing forward." People who are victims, they never move forward. They never press forward. They are stagnant. They become stationary. They resign to the fate. May God help us so that we may overcome this kind of victim mentality. And Macedonians, as we have said, were a good example, because they refused to be called poor, and they gave themselves to the Lord. And let me say, how do you overcome this poverty of the mind? How do you overcome poverty of the mind? The first thing that we find in this scripture, in 2 Corinthians, is that they gave themselves first to the Lord. So if you want to overcome the poverty, probably you are saying, "I am poor, I am a victim." The first thing to overcome this poverty and the victim mentality is to give yourself first to the Lord. You give yourself first to the Lord.
And the reason why, there are people who do not give even in the church. They don't give because they think they are poor. And I must say, even giving in the church is not determined by how much people have. Sometimes I look at because we usually look at the giving of our people, and you find even people who have very little money are the ones who are regular givers, and they pay their tithes. And people with a lot of money, they look for excuses of not giving their tithes. So giving is not determined by the how much you have, but it is determined by how much you have given yourself to the Lord. So even the service to the Lord is also determined by how much you have given yourself to the Lord. How much have you given yourself to the Lord? This will help you even to enjoy. And people who enjoy the service of the Lord, even in giving, in serving the Lord, they are those people that have given themselves to the Lord first. So if you want to enjoy your service as a man and a woman of God, first of all, give yourself first to the Lord. Not because of anything. Because there is the attitude, and this is the other bad attitude that I would want to bring to us. Why do we give our money to the church and to the work of the ministry? Sometimes we give so that we may receive. If that is the attitude, that is the wrong attitude already. We don't give so that we may receive. Although it is that there is the principle that is absolute, that and the principle in the Bible, when give and it shall be given to you, good measure. But that's not the attitude that we give it. When we give our tithe, when we give our offering, it is a service unto the Lord. It is a way of worship. And we give whether the Lord will give us, I will not care what the Lord will give me, but I will worship the Lord anyhow. So we give, we worship the Lord. And this is the attitude that you have. So giving is not twisting the heart of God. And I must say this again. Giving is not twisting the heart of God. When I say it's twisting the heart of God, if you want someone to submit to you, you twist his hand, you lasso him down, then he submits. So when we are giving, we are not lessoning God so that he may give us. It is an act of worship because we are made to worship the Lord. And that is the attitude that we should embrace. And that's why Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, although they were told they are going to be thrown into the fiery furnace, they said, you can throw us there, and it doesn't matter whether we perish, but we shall not worship this idol. And they said, we know God can deliver us, and even if he does not, we are not going to bow to the idol. So they were not worshiping God because they are going to be delivered from the fiery furnace. They knew they could perish. But they knew worship is paramount. Worship is important because we are made to worship the Lord. And this is the positive attitude when we are serving the Lord. When we are giving, we give because it is a worship unto the Lord. And there is joy in that when we worship the Lord with our giving. And this is the attitude of Macedonia. They give themselves first. You have given yourself to the Lord. Furthermore, you know, when you are giving, all what you have belongs to the Lord together with you. I always give an example. When I got married to my wife, and There were ladies who were assisting her, and she had the two boxes. And I believe in those two boxes were all her good clothes in those boxes. So she carried all her valuables in those boxes. And then she came. Because now she was ready to give herself to somebody. And she could not leave anything that was valuable. And because she was a teacher, she also came with her basin. So, herself and her basin, now she was ready to surrender. But the basin, before I received the basin, she first gave herself to me. Praise the Lord. And she knew once she becomes mine, even the basin is mine. Hallelujah. So when we give ourselves to the Lord, all that we have belongs to the Lord. Therefore, when we give, it is just like removing from one pocket to the other one, because all that I have belongs to the Lord. We belong to Him. Hallelujah. And that is why we give ourselves unreservedly. Hallelujah. Can you tell somebody to not be affected? And this is what we need to embrace. We give ourselves fully to the Lord. And there is joy when we give ourselves fully to the Lord. And this is what, this is the secret of the, and this is how you are going to be delivered from this victim mentality. You will serve the Lord with joy when you give yourself fully to the Lord. You will not be giving for you to be seen by the pastor, for you to be seen by others. Did you know there are people who give a lot of money when there is harambe, and they will not give even the second? Kwa sababu wanataka kujulikana wanapea. But when it is secret giving, they will not give. That means they are not giving to the Lord. They are giving for their own sake to be seen. But may God deliver us. That kind of a person is still a victim. Hallelujah. Say, I don't want to be a victim. I pray for liberation today. In the name of Jesus. So it is very important for you to deliver yourself from this victim mentality. Therefore, the first thing, give yourself first to the Lord. The second thing, do not believe everything you think. Sometimes there are things that come to our minds, our negative things, our negative feelings. There are times that you think sin. Nowadays it is very cold. And there was a day I sat in the office and it was very cold. I started feeling now I am sick. And I started now contemplating of how I will go to the hospital. And because I thought I was, but when I came out of the office, it was a bit sunny. I felt kumbe I was not sick. It is only that it was very cold. Sometimes what you feel and what you think is not what you are. Don't always believe everything that you think. Embrace the positive thinking. Because Jeremiah chapter 17 verse number 9, it says, the heart is deceitful. It is important for you even to question your mind. Don't believe everything that you think. If you think you are defeated, you become defeated. The spies that were sent by Moses to go and spy the land of Canaan, when they saw the giants in Canaan, they thought these people can swap us around. And that is, it is not impossible. However big those people were, they could not swallow them. And they suffered from what we call grasshopper syndrome. And they thought that we are defeated. We are like grasshoppers in front of them. No, we cannot defeat these people. So they suffered and they became victims. Even before they were fed, they victimized themselves. But I thank God for Caleb, who said, no, we are well able. Let us go and occupy the land. Praise the Lord. So the second thing, do not believe everything that you think. It is good even to think it twice. And question your mind. Question your mind. Hata ukifikiri kitu, question. And you ask yourself whether you are in the right frame of mind. Shika kichwa yako na mna hii. Wakati mwingine uliwa na yunusa. Am I in the right frame of mind? So do not believe everything. The second thing, guard your mind from garbage. Proverbs chapter 4. Let me see whether I am quoting the right fact. You got the book of Proverbs. Chapter 4, verse number 23, it says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Another version says, guard your heart because it is the wellspring of life. Guard your heart. Guard your heart so that because it is a well can become filthy if you allow garbage to go into that well. So take care of your well so that garbage do not go into that well. And there are times that we feed our hearts with garbage. Nutritionists tells us there are three kinds of food for your physical body. These are the nutritionists. For the sake of information, there are food that there is brain food that makes you smarter. There is junk food that employs calories, and there is toxic food that poisons, that is poisonous. I'm not an expert, this is just some research. There is food that will make your brain smarter. There is food that is junk that will add calories to your body, and there is toxic food that poisons your body. And even in your heart, there are things that become junk. If you eat junk, you become obese and you become vulnerable and very susceptible to heart problem and diabetes. But what do you feed your heart? And during our time, it is very important. What do you watch? What do you watch in the internet? What do you watch? What program do you watch the TV? In the TV? What kind of discussion do you engage in? Do you always talk of negative things? Are you in the company of those things, people who do not see anything positive? Negative thinkers. Guard your heart, because everything that you do flows from that heart. There was once in one of our churches, a madman went and threw himself into one of our, into their borehole, and he died. And from that day, they covered that borehole and they said they will never drink the water out of that borehole. In fact, even when it was removed, they used that borehole like a latrine. They built and they said, this borehole from today, it will become a latrine. Because it killed a man. Because to them, nothing good. The water there has been defiled. And they cannot, the well has become dirty. So if you make your well dirty, even you become dirty and you become a victim. And may God help us. Let's feed ourselves with the positive things in our mind. And the way out is to pray. Pray every day. If you feel there are things that have become dirty, fix your mind and your thoughts and replace them with the positive thoughts. And pray positive prayers in the name of Jesus. Let me finish very fast. Never let up running. The other thing is run. Run, run, run. Jesus wants us to run. Continue to run. If you want to improve yourself, learn. Become an adventurous, seeking of knowledge. The Bible says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. Many people are dying and perishing because they lack information. Learning is not about going, is not only going to school. We grow. I usually tell my students, the moment that you stop learning, you start dying. And it is very important to keep dying. Life is a life, is a process. And it is important for you to learn, to continue learning. Learn from the environment. Learn from your experience. Learn from other people's experience. Learn from your failures. Because the fact that you failed yesterday, it does not mean that you are going to fail tomorrow. So learn from your faults and failures. Be a good student of yourself. Learn from other people. Stay with the people who will add value to you. Because the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 27, verse number 17, iron sharpens iron. You learn from other people. Have a teachable spirit. They are the know-it-all. Adult Kuambia, you have a revelation. Before you speak your revelation, they have just grasped it, and now they are telling you about the revelation. I have ever seen those people. I have come with a revelation and I want to share something the Lord has told me. Hata kabla sijaenda bali sana, nimwambie revelation. Yeye amepata revelation na yeye ananihubiria. So you see, be teachable, be humble. And a teachable person is a person who is ready to listen. And that is why the Lord has given you 2 ears and 1 mouth. Say 2 ears, 1. Masikio mawili mudomo. You listen twice as much as you talk. So learn, listen. Somebody said, and if you like quotation, he said, truth is never invented, it is discovered. So if you want to learn, truth is never invented, it is discovered. There are things that you have discovered. There are business that you have not discovered. There are things that you have not discovered. And these things are just with us. We have the potential. We have the potential. I want to finish with this one. Let God stretch your mind. Let God stretch your imagination. Praise the Lord. Say, God stretch my imagination. God stretch my imagination. And I want to finish with the one in Genesis chapter 15. Genesis chapter 15. In Genesis chapter 15, from verse number 1, and the one that I want us to look at is verse number 5. This is Abraham when, and the Lord was actually reminding Abraham of his covenant. And before verse number 5, it is like Abraham was complaining to God. And Abraham was telling God, you removed me from my own people and you told me to come into this wilderness. and you give me a heart, and I will become a father of great nation. And look at me now, I have grown old. I'm growing old, I have no son, even this my servant. Verse number 3, you have given me no children. So a servant in my household will be my hire. So he was kind of suffering. He was already a victim. He was suffering victim mentality of lack of a hire. And it is like he was telling God, you lied to me. God, I think you don't keep your promises. Now look at me. But the Lord, the word of the Lord came to him. And he told him, this man will not inherit you, but a son of your own flesh and blood will be your heir. Look at verse number 5. It's the one that I want you, because I said, let God stretch your mind, your imagination. And this is the prayer that I want us to come up with. Can you lift up your hand and say, God, stretch my imagination. God, stretch my imagination. And look at it, verse number 5, Genesis chapter 15. He took him outside and he said, look at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them, then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Praise the Lord. And he took him outside. And I think the sky was clear. And there were a lot of stars. And he told Abraham, can you take a moment and count the stars? Did you know that you cannot count the stars? There are so many. And if you can count these stars, this is how your generation shall be. And did you know, even the researcher says, the greatest tribe in the world is the tribe of it, are the children of Abraham. What about when the son of Dumiani was Ibrahim up to now? You go to America, you will find Israelites. And they are the greatest scientists there. You go to Russia, come to Kenya, go everywhere in the world, you will find Jewish. They are there. Don't look at Jewish in their own small country. In fact, the Jewish nation is the one that controls even the politics of the world. Did you know that? Did you know? The Jewish nation controls the political climate of the world? Yes. These children of Abraham, and the Bible says, Abraham believed and he was credited as righteous. Praise the Lord. This morning, may God stretch your imagination. Father, stand up on your feet, if you can, wherever you are, and tell God, stretch my imagination. Stretch my imagination. I do not want to be a victim. Stretch my imagination. And I want you to go to God in prayer. 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 We want to pray in the name of Jesus. We want to know, we do not want to suffer as victims. Yes, we are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. We are going to make it. Our business is going to grow. Our church is going to grow. My children will excel. I will prosper in the land of living. Yes, I'm not going to be oppressed. Yes, I'm going to be a ruler. I'm not going to be ruled. Yes, I am putting down the strongholds in my life. I'm not going to be dominated by coronavirus in the name of Jesus. Do not not be dominated by fear of coronavirus. Victims are dominated by fear of coronavirus in the name of Jesus. I will not be seeking sympathy in the name of Jesus. I am going to be free. And the Bible says, if it is the Son of Man who will set you free, you shall be free indeed. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we pray that you may deliver us. Deliver us more. Deliver us more. Deliver us more. Set us free more. We thank you, for you know and you understand us more than anybody else, oh God. You know what we might be lacking. You know the kind of suffering that we are going through. But we thank you because we are not victims. In the name of Jesus. 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 I don't know the kind of suffering you are going through. I don't know what you are lacking. I don't know, probably you are suffering from inferiority complex when you are suffering from, you become victims. You suffer from inferiority complex. You think other people are better than yourself. You think other people are better than you. You think you are disadvantaged. But I want to tell you, yes, you are privileged, you are blessed. In the name of the Lord, in the name of Jesus, may the Lord stretch your mind. May the Lord stretch your mind now. In the name of Jesus, Father, I thank you and I worship you because you are stretching your people's mind. You are helping your people to believe in themselves. Thank you, Lord. Nakushukuru na kuabudu. Uinuliwe na utukuzwe milele. Katika jina la Yesu. Let's pray in the name of the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you may deliver us. Help us not to be victims, but to be victors. Help us not to be conquered, but to be conquerors. Help us to believe in ourselves and to believe in your works. Help us to believe in your word. Help us to guard our hearts, because it is the wellspring of life. We thank you for this day, and we thank you for speaking to us in the name of Jesus. I'm praying for my listener today, Lord. You have spoken to him. You have spoken to her. You know what he or she desperately needs at this point in time. But I pray in the name of the Lord that you may come through for him. Come through for him. Come through for her. Come through for her family. Come through for her business. Come through, oh Lord, because you are God and there is none like you. Father, I thank you for your hand. Father, I thank you for you have done it. Father, I thank you because you are good. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Utukuzwe na uinuliwe milele. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Probably you have never given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are listening to me right now. There is a grace of salvation. You can be counted as one in the kingdom of God. You have never given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord is inviting you. You are heaven-headed. You have been living like a victim. You have become a victim of your own problems, probably drunkenness, immorality, bad behavior, corruption. You feel condemned. You abuse your wife, you abuse your children, you abuse yourself with the drugs, and you abuse drugs. Jesus Christ is saying, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and you will find rest in Him. Today the Lord is knocking the door of your heart. And He says, if you hear this knock, open to come and dine with you. In the name of Jesus, you can be saved today. Say, Father, come into my heart. I forsake Satan with all his desires, with all his works, with all his practices. And today I surrender my life to you. Come, enter into my heart. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. I will follow you. Make me a new creature. Make me a son in the kingdom. Thank you, Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for my listener. The one that is accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Remove his name in the book of death and write his name in the book of life. In the name of Jesus, and from today, give him or her the joy of living. Thank you, Lord, because you are doing it. In Jesus' name I pray. If you have given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, look for a Bible-believing church. Look for a pastor who believes in the Bible and become a member there and give you a testimony. And may God bless you. I am coming from the Full Gospel Churches of Kenya, Kiambu. You can also join with us in the Facebook, also in our YouTube, Bishop Simon Mwangi Muleini. And may God bless you, and may God stretch your mind and deliver you from victim mentality. God bless you. Pastor Sam Karimi.
Amen. Glory to Jesus. Wow, it has been such a wonderful moment in the presence of the Lord, and God has spoken to us, and it is my prayer that the spirit of victim mentality will disappear from our lives in the name of Jesus, that we shall begin to think positively, we shall begin to trust God even for greater things in our lives. My takeaway home is that for us to be able to overcome the poverty mentality and the victim mentality is that we must give ourselves to the Lord first. Praise the name of the Lord. That we must give ourselves to the Lord. And giving ourselves means that we give our hearts, we give our lives, we whatever God has given it to us. And we have been told that we don't give because of how much we have, but we give because it is a service and a worship unto the Lord. Hallelujah. That if we overcome the mentality, the victim mentality, we must not believe every thought, and we must learn to question the thoughts that comes in our minds and engage positive thinking. We must also guard our heart from garbage. And finally, we must not give up learning in the name of Jesus. Such a powerful one in a season like this one. And our prayer is that may the Lord deliver us from the victim mentality. May the Lord help us to renew our minds so that the perfect will of God upon our lives will prevail in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Just lift up your hand in the presence of the Lord and tell the Lord, I refuse to be a victim. I refuse to be a victim. I refuse to be poor. I refuse to walk in sickness and diseases. I refuse to be under. I refuse to walk as a victim. But Lord, I pray that I shall develop a victor's mentality, that I shall always be the head and not the tail. I shall be above and not be neither. I shall be rich and not poor. I shall lead even in my family. I shall lead in my society. I shall lead in the church. I shall be better than yesterday. I refuse to walk and seek sympathy. But God Almighty, help me Jesus. I thank you, Lord, and we give you the glory. Have your way in our hearts. As you encourage us, have your way in our lives. Lord, we pray that this one will find a place in our hearts, that this one will bear fruit 30, 60, and 100-fold to the glory and honor of our God. We love you and we worship you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, 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 amen. Our hearts are encouraged in the Lord. And this time we want to give ourselves to the Lord. We want to have an opportunity when we can give ourselves and give our substances, pay our tithes and our offerings this afternoon in the name of Jesus. Please somebody get a basket for us. We want to get an opportunity to give. Get an opportunity to give. And for those who are paying through our M-Pesa, we'd like to introduce to you our PayBill number. We'd like to introduce to you our PayBill number. We have been paying through the PayBill number, but now we have a till number. Right now we have a till number, and that is what I would like to encourage us to give through. And our PayBill account number, now it is not PayBill. Now it is?
It is PayBill.
It is PayBill.
PayBill.
Now it is our M-Pesa PayBill. Do we still use the 247-247?
No.
No. Now we just need to put the number 4029303. Can I repeat again? Our PayBill number is 4029303. If you can write somewhere, 4029303. That is our PayBill account number. You can, if you are paying through M-Pesa, you can send your money to that number and you to come to the Full Gospel Churches of Kenya, Kiambu. And it is an improvement and from what you were doing before. And the Lord will bless you. Those who are here and probably you came with liquid cash, I want to give you an opportunity to give. You can drop your offering at the back front here. Then we are going to pray together as we wind up the service this afternoon in the name of Jesus. Let us all stand, bring our offerings to the front, and the Lord will bless us in the name of Jesus. We want to pray together in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Shall not walk in victory. your perfect will shall prevail upon our lives. We worship you. Thank you for your servant, and thank you for using your servant in such a special and in a mighty way this afternoon. Continue to bless him. We give you glory and we give you honor. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. And surely goodness and mercies shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. Our second service begins shortly. Please, we are coming back. We are in